Well, let's go to our panel now. Sergei Markov joins us from Moscow. He's the director of the Institute of Political Studies and a professor at the Moscow State Institute of International Relations. And in New York, we have Andrei Dobryansky. He's a Ukrainian-American political analyst. Gentlemen, thanks for joining us on the Newsmakers once again. Sergei Markov, let me ask you, who killed Alexander Zakharchenko?
Enemies of Alexander Zakharchenko kill him, those who promised to kill him. It's Ukrainian intelligence service or Ukrainian military intelligence service or Ukrainian neo-Nazi group. They many times told that they're prepared to do it. Of course, it's clear political terrorism, the policy of governmental terrorism. And Russia and Moscow still didn't find no response to the terrorism. Russia cannot use same methods or to help to right. the Donbas to use same terroristic method because we are not terrorists. But what to do if terrorists kill and kill your friends many times, we still don't know.
Okay. Andrei, and we've also got the Russian Foreign Minister Sergei Lavrov stating that the bombing was Ukraine's provocation, obviously aimed at derailing the implementation of the Minsk agreements. It seems as if the Ukrainians have motive and capability, and so they took out this guy who they believe is illegally operating on Ukrainian soil. Is that the way you can maybe accept it being seen by many others?
I think you're quite right when you say that these individuals are acting illegally on Ukrainian soil. They are the terrorists that are active on Ukrainian territory. I think one thing I would point out to you, however, is that this terrorist who was recently killed, he was a self-proclaimed and proclaimed by Moscow as the leader of one of these occupying republics. He signed on to the Minsk Accord in a way of glorifying what his terror cell saw itself as a mini country state. The other person who was representing the Russian terrorists on Ukrainian soil, Igor Plotnitsky, was also a co-signer at that point to the Minsk Accords. He has since also disappeared. Removed from power, they say. Was that because of Ukrainians? No. That is because the instability of a terror network, which is what is operating on Ukrainian territory in areas that are surrounded by Russian military personnel.
Okay. And Sergei, other separatist leaders have been killed by bombs in recent history. Mikhail Tolstikh and Arseniy Pavlov, also known as Motorola. Now, according to the best available evidence, these guys were probably killed in infighting, right? Seen as warlords competing against each other. So, even though Ukraine might have motive, might not like these guys, is it possible, Mr. Markov, that what we're seeing is just infighting? These are warlords killing each other and vying for power in the East?
Not. I think it's impossible. We have some kind of partisan-style rebellion against neo-Nazi junta in the 2014, and but then it's these rebellion groups have been organized in a real army with real discipline, and this army, of course, has clear and strong support for the Russia. And Vladimir Putin many times mentioned, we will not allow military solution of Donbas. As Alexander Zakharchenko terrorist or not, everybody could see how he had been supported by people. More than 100,000 of the people come on his bearing. Nevertheless, of course, people afraid that Kyiv Bandera junta can organize again terroristic bombing in the crowds to kill some of the average people. So I think no chance. This is one of the arguments which used by terrorists. I want to say again, Zakharchenko, Alexander Zakharchenko, fought against neo-Nazis on his soil. His soil is Donbas, and he protected right of the people to live how they want to live. That's why Alexander Zakharchenko is Democrat, And he defended democracy. And democracy means that government has such policy which people demand from the government. But those who illegally grip power in Kyiv in 2014, they used terroristic attack against Donbas people all these years. And to my regret, Russia still has no response how to react. Okay. Kyiv junta is some kind of
okay, and you see them.
State,
okay, and it's interesting that you see them as a junta. That's fascinating. Andrei Dobryansky, we're seeing very clearly the Russian perspective on things in the east here. They believe that the government in Kyiv in the west is actually illegitimate. With Minsk in mind and the reality on the ground, with the OSCE's reports, and they're saying they're still fighting every night. There are people in the so-called gray zone who are without electricity, without water, many displaced. More than 10,000 have been killed over these years. Is anybody committed to peace, Andrei?
Absolutely. Day by day, you see Ukraine deploying aid workers, especially for the towns that have been liberated from the oppression of the terrorists. New job opportunities, job training programs for those people have been set up, rebuilding the infrastructure in those areas as well. It is a very difficult situation when you have one rogue state, namely Russia, invading a sovereign territory of Ukraine. I would like to point out that over 100 nations at the United Nations have reaffirmed that Ukraine is its own sovereign territory. Russia does not get to dictate or to occupy it. So whatever is happening there is completely illegal on the side of the Russian invaders. But for me, it's less important to know what happened to these terrorists that are being mentioned today in the news cycle. It was interesting to hear that hundreds of thousands, earlier this morning, it was tens of thousands at a funeral. By midnight, it'll be a million people at this funeral. But that's not the person you should mourn. The person we should mourn are the 298 innocent people who were killed by these terrorists when their plane flew over eastern Ukraine. Over 80 of those were children under the age of 16. We will never know what happened to that, to them specifically, nor will we know who are these doing these killings in Ukraine right now, because Western observers are not allowed into these areas. Western observers would like to go to the sovereign territory of Ukraine, right up to the border, to see exactly what's happening there. And they are not allowed in because, again, a terrorist regime has been installed there by Moscow. Moscow openly talks about this in the book by President Hollande of France. He mentioned that Putin openly spoke about it in the Minsk format, that Putin admitted that his forces were involved in the invasion of Ukraine. So it's not about these terrorists that are killed today. It's about the innocent people, as you mentioned, the over 10,000, the largest displacement in Europe since World War II, over 2 million people displaced in Ukraine because of these actions.
Sergei Markov, are Germany and France the right mediators to try and resolve the conflict right now in what they call the Normandy talks?
I think now Normandy talks is frozen because leaders of France and Germany didn't accused terrorist attack which had been organized by a Kyiv neo-Nazi junta. And that's why it means that we regard that France and Germany supported that Kyiv killing his political opponents. And I want to stress to Mr. Dobryansky, terrorists is those who every night shelling by artillery the houses where people live. And it's exactly troops, Ukrainian troops, by order of Kyiv junta. And be sure, Mr. Dobryansky.
And that could be verified
Ukraine
by international monitors if you
Ukraine
let them into that area.
Ukraine will be free from neo-Nazis. And the people as you are will
right.
be persona
so on the territory of
Ukraine,
Ukraine that Western monitors can go
free.
Into,
and
in those areas that are being shelled by the Russians,
Germany.
Western monitors can
and
verify that. They can't verify that in areas that
Ukraine
are occupied by Russians.
Again, your support of neo-Nazi terrorists would not help them. Now it's helped them a little bit. And now you are keeping responsibility for the killing such hero of anti-fascism movement and rebellion as Alexander Zakharchenko. You can even dance with neo-Nazis from Azov and another neo-Nazis battalion, which is used by Kiev gun. But it would help you because history is against people as you are.
Andrei.
Yes, so the person being hailed as a hero is a known felon with a criminal record. Again, my colleague on the other side does not recognize the innocent people who are dying every day because of Russian shelling, nor the innocent members of the European Union, the Malaysians, Australians, who were shot down in that airplane. If the Russians were to allow international monitors, all these accusations that are being levied today by my colleague on the other side can be verified. But they're not verified because Russia will not allow international monitors. They are just saying that these things are happening. Ukraine, on the other hand, has allowed international monitors, and that's why we can document all these international abuses that are happening to this day.
Sergei Markov and Andrei Dobryansky.
Of course.
Sergei, unfortunately, we're out of time. I have to move on.
Yeah, of course, Mr. Dobryansky lied. All international observers are free to come to the territory of pre-Donbass.
Okay, well, let's have a round two next time with both of you. But unfortunately, we're out of time. So thanks for joining us once again on the Newsmakers.